So this film is about society and culture in Russia, in the Soviet Union under Stalin between 1928 and 1953. And of course, when we're thinking about what was society like and what was going on culturally in Russia at that time, we have to be aware of the context. And the context was political repression and political terror everywhere and economic transformation. The so-called Great Turn, the attempt to turn the Soviet Union into a great industrial country and the collectivization of agriculture. So that's the context within which we have to think about any social or cultural changes in Russia in this period. In Stalin's Soviet Union, all forms of culture had to conform, and they had to conform to socialist standards, conform to standards that Stalin himself set. He told writers that they were the engineers of the human soul, and he gave them instructions that any of their work had to appeal to and be understood by proletarians, by the working class, and it had to reflect proletarian culture. So there was a Soviet school of writing and of art known as socialist realism, whereby any kind of artists or any cultural expression, any cultural output was supposed to reflect the ideals of socialism, reflect the ideals of heroic workers, building a new workers' state, building a workers' paradise. So there were lots of pieces of art that were produced that were of workers in factories and in mines, or there were lots of paintings produced of agricultural workers, farm workers working on collective farms. Plays were written about workers like that. Films were made of industrial workers and collective farm workers. There was no space in Soviet culture for self-expression. That was regarded as rather decadent or rather bourgeois. The whole purpose of art and culture was to produce a useful product, something that would support the state's drive for economic transformation. And that applied to all kind of artistic and cultural forms. It applied to novels that were written, films that were written, poetry that was written. Plays, ballets, theatrical productions, and any kind of artistic products that didn't conform to those kinds of socialist ideals was in danger of being shut down, and the artists that created those works were in danger of being purged. And many artists, many musicians, many creative people were purged. They were arrested, were sent off to concentration camps. Probably the most famous, or one of the most famous, was the Russian novelist Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who was sent off to the Gulag and later wrote a book about it called One Day in the Life of Alexander Solzhenitsyn and the Gulag Archipelago. Even the famous Russian composer Dmitri Shostakovich was told that some of the symphonies and some of the operas he wrote were too bourgeois and he was forbidden from performing them. This was the kind of atmosphere within which artists and anyone producing creative works had to operate in the 1930s, 40s, and early 50s in Stalin's Soviet Union. Another famous feature of Stalin's Soviet Union, something that had a kind of cultural impact or an impact on society, was him, the cult of Stalin's personality. There were images of Stalin absolutely everywhere. There were statues erected of him in towns and cities across the country. There were portraits hung of him everywhere. Every workplace had his portrait hanging up. Schools had his portrait hanging up. In every classroom of every school, there'd be a portrait of Stalin above the door. You could buy vinyl records where on one side there was a recording of Stalin giving a speech, and on the other side of the record was just an entire side of recorded applause to the speech that Stalin had given. Stalin was claimed to be the great genius of the Soviet Union, the great inheritor of Lenin's Bolshevik project, Lenin's right-hand man who was carrying on Lenin's project. And famously, one of the ways in which he did this was that any images from the past that showed Stalin playing a slightly lesser role or other members of the Bolshevik Party playing a major role were altered. I'm sure you've all have seen photos of Lenin, say, in the early 1920s giving speeches, where Trotsky might be to his side, or another leading member of the Bolshevik Party would be alongside with Lenin. Well, in the 30s, 40s and 50s, those pictures were airbrushed so that any opponents of Stalin's had been airbrushed out of history, and Stalin was placed there instead. And of course, the idea is to present him as always being by Lenin's side and always being Lenin's chosen successor, even though that clearly wasn't the case. You know, Lenin had written some scathing things about Stalin in his last testament in 1922. Education was also reshaped in the Stalinist period. The whole purpose and focus of education was to provide a disciplined and strict training for young people so that they would be ready to enter the workplace, because that was the whole purpose of the Soviet Union. It was to industrialize, to strengthen, to modernize. And in order to do that successfully, it needed well-disciplined, well-trained young people to graduate from schools and universities to go into the workplace. There was an expansion of universities, and there was an expansion of specialist schools as well to train the future industrial specialists that the Soviet Union would need. And there was inequality in education in the Soviet Union. Those children of party members often had access, well, always had access to the better schools, the more specialist training institutions, and access to educational and career opportunities that children who weren't of party members didn't have access to. Just like in Nazi Germany, there was also a youth movement. It was called the Komsomol, the Young Communist League. And just like in Nazi Germany with the Hitler Youth, those children were expected to wear uniforms and to worship Stalin and to, you know, build self-reliance and build skills and be loyal Stalinists, report on anyone that they suspected of being suspicious or an opponent of Stalin in any way. One of the key groups in society that came under attack during the Stalinist years was the church. Orthodox religion, which had deep roots in Russian society, was officially, I'm going to say frowned upon, but it was more than that. It was regarded as completely unnecessary. The Communist Party was building a new kind of society where religion would be irrelevant. And so the churches were persecuted. Members of the clergy were arrested, sent into exile, sent into prison camps. Churches were shut down, synagogues were shut down, mosques were shut down. Remember, Russia, the Soviet Union, was a huge empire that encompassed lots of different ethnic minorities and lots of different religious beliefs. So there were lots of Jews, there were lots of Muslims, as well as Orthodox Christians, and people of religion of all faiths were persecuted in the Stalin years. There was a lot of resistance to that, especially in the countryside, where those religious traditions were particularly strong and particularly ingrained into people's way of life. But the regime was pretty successful in persecuting the churches. By 1940, for example, only 1% of the churches that had been open in 1917 were still open. Stalin was shrewd enough to relax the persecution of the churches a little bit during the Second World War, because he realised that the people, although the church might have been persecuted, a lot of people were still of faith, and a lot of people still derived comfort from going to church, And Stalin thought it was necessary to let people have that during the Second World War. And he painted the Second World War not as a war to preserve communism or to preserve Bolshevism. He painted it as the great patriotic war, where everybody in the country needed to rally to the country's defense. And to defend, he even used the words Holy Russia. He was shrewd enough to know that he could tap into that kind of religious sentiment that was still so ingrained in Russian people. And so whilst there was this program of persecution against the churches, he still, you know, it wasn't completely destroyed. The churches weren't completely destroyed. And in fact, after the Second World War, the persecution of the churches let up a little bit because Stalin thought that they might be a useful tool for him, although the consequence for the church was that they basically became an arm of government. Arguably, much like they had been in Tsarist times. Another major kind of social feature of the Stalinist years was its relative conservatism. When the Bolsheviks had first come to power in late 1917, Lenin had talked about the family, for example, being a bourgeois unit, a bourgeois construction that was a crucial part of capitalism. And he said that capitalism had enslaved women, had made them into homemakers and childbearers while the men were out working. And he called for a liberation of women. And he called for the end of the bourgeois nuclear family. And so in the 1920s, divorce was made easier, abortion was made easier. There was less sort of official emphasis on the family. But when Stalin came to power at the end of the 1920s and going into the 1930s and beyond, he thought that in order for his projects, primarily the economic transformation of the Soviet Union, in order for that project to be successful, that society needed to be stable. And so there was a move away. In fact, there was a reversal of the policies that Lenin had brought in the 1920s, and much more conservative, pro-family policies were brought in. Divorce was made much harder. Access to abortions were made much harder. There was much more emphasis on traditional ideas of women's roles in society and of women's roles as bringing up the family. Having said that, women were still expected to be key workers as well, to participate in the industrial modernization of the country. So arguably, life became even harder for women because not only did they have to fulfill their traditional roles of being wife and housewife, but they also had to work in the factories as well. So Stalinist culture, the whole context really is that you have to remember that terror pervaded society in the 1930s. Terror and fear and conformity. And Stalin wanted that conformity, and he wanted any kind of social organization or any kind of social structure or cultural organization to consolidate his overall project of the economic transformation of the Soviet Union. And in many ways, he therefore created quite a conservative society, one that reinforced the role of the family, and very conservative in terms of the kind of art and cultural expression that was approved of.